welcome back to the show once again. Always a pleasure to see our next guest. He occasionally watches the game of hockey as well and occasionally pulls for our hometown Vancouver Canucks. So it's a theme throughout the show today.
And another theme with him, of course, is Talk Minus Action Equals Zero, which is the name of the new book. Joe Keithley from DOA is joining us now. How are you?
All right, Joe.
I'm doing great. How you doing?
Good.
So you wouldn't qualify for an episode of Hoarders, you said. You don't quite have that much memorabilia around?
Well, I am able to part with some of this stuff. Like, I have gathered it up over the years. This new book, I had about 14 boxes. boxes this big of posters, pictures, memorabilia.
Tickets,
and
you name it.
I managed to pare it down to about 9. So I won't let go of the other 9.
So you've got 14 boxes, and it's all neatly put into a book now. But I can't imagine what it was like logistically to organize this book. How did you do it?
Well, it took me about a week to go through the boxes, and not like 10 hours a day.
Were the boxes were they like layers? Were they organized sequentially?
No, they weren't organized at all.
Excellent.
So I finally dug out about 500 posters, went down to the book publisher, and they had a big boardroom table, and I took the box, and I kind of dumped it upside down, a couple boxes, and said, there you go, there's the book. And they kind of went, what the F? Type thing. And so then we sorted it into years.
Yeah.
And sort of tried to get, like, because the book's written in a linear fashion from year one to year.
It's a really, really effective way to sort of give people an idea because, you know, I think everybody sort of has, you know, when you're a certain age, they have little glimpses of DOA through the years.
Yeah.
But it's just a really cool way to sort of go through it and really see the, you know, the posters you guys were putting out, the halls that you were playing in, some of the pictures and stuff. Does anything stick out for you? I mean, or does it all sort of... I mean, there's got to be little
flashes. No, it's not a blur. It's not...
But you know what I mean? Like, there's those little punctuation points that kind of hit in any life.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like... well, I mean, I would never suspect that... I probably said this on the show. I would never suspect that we would have gone on for 33 years plus
crazy.
Type thing. But it was just fun to kind of encapsulate the whole thing and put it into one book and put it, like, in a line... and explain why we did this, like why the stupid things we did, the smart things did, a lot of stupid things.
Right? Yeah. keeping all this stuff, did you have it in your mind that you were going to do something like this, or was it just saving it for the sake of saving it?
Yeah, when you're young, like, who
thinks to save it? I just happened to save it, and then as years went by, I realized, oh, I should keep posters. And usually when I would arrive at a venue, I would grab one on the spot. I'd look for, like, the local... poster for that.
Yeah.
Now, the part of the problem was with the 14 boxes, a lot of them were that repeated the same sort of imagery, like or the skull or the DOA arrows or something like that. So we really had to pare that down and then make a story out of it. So then we had to kind of look on the internet.
Well, let's look at some of the images that we have.
Love this first one. Yeah, you chose a few for us today. Explain this one and how that fits into the lore.
Right. Okay. This was like basically the skulls was the predecessor to DOA, and we got like a break and got added on to this build, which the original punk rock bands around the scene. But you can see that we weren't really on the bill, so we would go around and scratch out the other band's name that had been canceled and put the skulls, right?
The skulls. My, how times have changed. Okay, let's go to the next one.
What were the
And tell us where when this is. Hardcore,
okay, this is the old Richards on Richards Club on Richards.
Yeah.
And it used to be called The Laundromat. And we put out this album, Hardcore 81, and we organized this hardcore festival with us, Black Flag, and a bunch of other bands. And it was a two-night thing, and it went really well and kind of gave birth to that whole term,
hardcore
as music, right?
Were you guys fairly gentle on venues? Because you talk at one point about the struggle sometimes to find venues that didn't know who you guys were, had no idea what you were going to...
Yes, okay. No, we would actually, the way we used to rent halls in Vancouver, I would phone up and I say, hello, yes, I'd like to rent a hall, your hall. And they go, oh, what for? I go, it's for a young people's concert.
Destruction!
And then they would go how many chairs would you like put up? And I go, oh, I don't think we need chairs.
Yeah,
chairs
will not be required.
Because the chairs can just get thrown around as
fast. Just stand up event.
Oh, you mean weapons? No, we won't be requiring those.
We don't need chairs, right?
Thank you. Okay, let's look at the next picture and tell us the story behind this one.
This was at the Eastern Front in Berkeley, California. And it was a two-day festival, open air type thing. And where we played was all like a dusty field in front of us. Like it was overlooking the bay, San Francisco Bay. And punks used to, it's pretty funny because punks used to wear bandanas for like as a fashion thing around their neck or on their waist or whatever, kind of a rock thing. And whenever the mosh pit would start, because it was all dust and dirt, this cloud of dust would come up. So finally, the bandanas had a real purpose, right, like the cowboys used to have.
And as a filter.
The punks are like, they'd start pulling their bandanas
up. How important was that West Coast run, and especially San Francisco, in DOA's history and into, you know, making you realize that you were sort of, you know, you were doing the things that you wanted to do, and you were sort of on the right track?
It really opened up the whole circuit, because we started going to SF first. The very first trip, I took a train, two guys took the bus, and one guy hitchhiked. That was our form of transport.
No equipment when you got
arrived
there.
Arrived with no gear, yeah. And the owner said, are you Canadians this stupid? And I kind of went, I don't know.
I was answering, like, yes.
20 years yeah. type thing, and... So we started traveling there, and the word got out pretty quick, and then we got a break and started playing some shows in L.A. So, and then we went to San Diego, and then we got to be friends with all the bands like Black Flag, the Avengers, yeah. the Dills, like that made up the original hardcore scene.
Well, and you see all these guys that were so important for you guys to play with and everything else, and then at some point in the transition, it sort of flips, and all of a sudden, DOA's working and opening headlining
right.
for all these little bands that are so... Bands like
Nirvana.
Let's see this, like,
right, when, right. Did you, Nirvana. When did Nirvana open for you guys?
I think that was like 88 or something. Like this was in Seattle.
DOA and Coffin Break and
Nirvana.
So it would have been about second show for Nirvana?
I think it was their second show. They came on and people kind of looked at them like, no idea they would be big.
Right? A feeling that you're familiar with from when you first started, right?
Well, that gives you the value why you should always be nice to their bands, because, you know.
You don't know.
There's an old show business statement that says, the people you step on the way up, they step on you on the way down.
Right.
So try to be nice as you go by.
And
right,
another you know? Show you had at Graceland here in Vancouver in the mid-80s, I guess. Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
DOA, headliner, No Means No, and Soundgarden open for you guys.
Yeah, and a great band, two great bunch of guys, and that was a great show. It was like echoey as Graceland always was, right? A bunch of metal and cement. But
Well, very and cool. I think you guys really, I mean, for a lot of bands too, not only do you guys teach them about music, but I think for a lot of them, you're an inspiration about not just playing music, but standing for something and really standing up and being represented and talking about.
Yeah, people would get the idea of the politics and the activism of DOA. And for a lot of people, like in a lot of these bands, DOA would have been either their first or second punk rock experience.
Right? Yeah.
The first bands they would have seen in large parts of Canada and States would have been either DOA or Black Flag.
Yeah.
And same thing when we went to Europe. We went to a lot of towns. People go like, we've never seen punk rock before, right? So I mean, that's what I'm trying to do with the book, give you an idea of like all the places we've been, because it starts out locally in Vancouver. Then it covers the United States and going to Canada.
China, Japan, Europe.
And going to Europe and playing all these like squats and these activist-type scenes and anti-war rallies and stuff like that.
Well, it's a great history of the music. Talk Minus Action Equals Zero is going to be released on June the 1st. You guys have a big show happening as well if you want to check it out. It's going to be at the Rickshaw at June 4th. It's a big party for the release of the book and some great music, too. Thanks so much, Joe.
Very quickly. Talk about our Vancouver Canucks for a second, Joe. Are you a fan?
Canucks, you know what? When I was 11, I used to go see the Canucks before they were in the NHL when they first built the Coliseum. And it's unbelievable. I've been waiting 40 years. And
fingers crossed.
10 down, 6 to go.
And we're going to continue on that theme after the break.